of being here at UNU, working here. We're in very good hands with my colleague Sebastian von Einsiedel this evening. I just wanted to say a word about how pleased we are that the Embassy of the Netherlands thought of UNU for this very interesting, indeed important, event. The Chargé d'Affaires of the Dutch Embassy will have more to say just now, but the Netherlands has been an extraordinary host for a great deal of international legal activity, a number of courts and tribunals. It's also been very welcoming to certain dimensions of the world, disarmament and arms control, institutional frameworks. So the Netherlands is really a model international citizen in all of those respects. And the International Criminal Court is, it's hard for us to remember, but a very recent development in the flow of history, because the Rome Statute was concluded in, unless I'm mistaken, 1998, so not long ago at all. The International Criminal Tribunals, which in a way precipitated interest in creating a more universal international criminal court, were only created a few years earlier. And in 1990, when I first went to work at the UN, nobody was thinking of international criminal justice or institutions in this field, except perhaps for a few lawyers and some very dedicated NGOs, all of whom were comprehensively ignored by everybody. So, Sace, over to you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, David, for your kind words. HagueTalks, let me say a few words about HagueTalks. International justice and rule of law is, of course, the cornerstone of Netherlands' foreign policy, as it is for Japan. In the 70 years after World War II ended, the international community built an international system based on the principles of rule of law and human rights. Although almost universally shared, unfortunately, these principles are not always put into practice. HagueTalks was created as a platform for dialogue around the world aimed to set peace and justice in motion. These HagueTalks serve as a meeting place for creative minds, peace inventors, and game changers in the field of peace and justice. And I'm very honored that His Excellency Judge Song is here with us today. With his long career devoted to promoting international justice, Judge Song most certainly is such a game changer. As for the creative minds in inventing peace, I hope that tonight we will hear innovative ideas from the audience as well. Finally, I'm thankful for the cooperation with UN University, and in particular also Sebastian von Einsiedel, who will lead the conversation with Judge Song tonight. And again, we need new ideas to sustain the relative peace in the world, which we experienced after the end of the World War II, and to meet the new challenges the international community faces today. Thank you very much for participating.
Thank you so much, Sees, for your introductory remarks, and thank you also for partnering up with us on this event in your Hague Talk series. It is now a particular honor for me to welcome our guest tonight, Judge Song Sang-Hyun, who until recently has served for 12 years as a judge at the International Criminal Court, the last 6 years of which as the court's president. Now, most people in this room will be aware that the ICC was created in 2002 by the Rome Statute, as Vector Malone has just said. And I think it's fair to say that it marked a watershed event maybe not only in international law, but in international relations. It was the first permanent international court set up to hold to account perpetrators of the most egregious crimes: genocide, war crimes, crimes against humanity, and aggression. Judge Song had an illustrious career in international law even before joining the ICC for 30 years. He taught as a law professor at Seoul National University, and he held several visiting professorships at some of the world's top law schools, including Harvard and NYU. And as an advisor to the Korean Supreme Court and its Ministry of Justice, he was at the forefront of a number of initiatives to reform the Korean criminal justice system. So there are a few people in the world better placed to explain to us both the significance of the International Criminal Court as well as its challenges. But Judge, before we get to that, a more personal question. Why did you get appointed in 2003 to become a judge at the International Criminal Court, and what led you to seek that appointment?
Well, formalistically, because my own government had nominated me for the election of the first ICC judges. But it is because of my personal war experience. You see, I was only 9 years old when the Korean War broke out, and for 3 months during the fierce battle for Seoul City, my entire family was hiding in a deep, hot, and humid bunker, underground bunker. And I was the only family member solely responsible for the food. So to get some food, I had to walk pretty much 16 kilometers every day to collect some potatoes and zucchinis and eggplants and tomatoes and things like that. During these trips, daily trips, I passed hundreds of dead bodies lying on the street, and to this day, I can precisely remember the horrible stench of the decomposing corpse in those hot summer days. For a long time, for many years, I loudly wondered why the human beings are so cruel, brutal to each other. How such a tragic armed conflict can be prevented. Of course, that led me to choose to study law in the earlier times of my career. And then, you know, subsequently for decades, I remain seriously interested in international law, which I believe should and can be used as an effective mechanism to prevent this tragic armed conflict. That's how I started.
And we will get to the question on how well the court has done in this respect. But before doing so, I wonder whether you could maybe help the audience situate the historical significance of the Rome Statute and how much of an innovation the ICC is in international law.
You see, with the Nuremberg and Tokyo tribunals and much later with the ICTY and ICTR, the international criminal law began to emerge as a distinct field of public international law. The significance of these tribunals is that for the first time in the human history, justice and judicial process were placed at the heart of a resolution to an armed conflict. The punishment of individuals was treated as a fundamentally important aspect of ensuring sustainable peace established on the basis of respect for the rule of law. The treaty-based nature of the ICC, as opposed to the Security Council resolution-based nature, enhance ICC's independence and legitimacy. And in addition, now the ICC is a permanent and readily available court with broad jurisdiction. You see, you talk about achievement and innovation and all this along that line. Well, first of all, the ICC has exceeded expectation in many ways. It came into being much faster than expected. The ICC has not only survived, but also thrived, despite early opposition, very serious one, by some powerful countries which sought to discredit the ICC altogether. And furthermore, the first referral of a situation by the UN Security Council in 2005 also exceeded expectations, as many observers thought that the United States would veto any Security Council effort to refer a situation to the ICC. And up until the creation of the ICC in 2002, the United Nations, in my view, maintained the peace and stability with the two major mechanisms. One, the ICJ. The other one is collective security system of the UN Security Council. Yet the international community acutely felt that a real peace cannot be achieved and that the accountability therefore cannot be ensured unless mass crime perpetrators, the individual mass crime perpetrators, are brought to justice. The birth of the ICC is the culminating point. In addition to criminal justice by prosecuting individual perpetrators to end impunity, the introduction of various mechanisms for victim protections is, again, very innovative and even unprecedented in the human history. You see, as you know, victims are allowed to fully participate in the criminal proceedings, and we created the Trusted Fund for Victims, which actively engage in diverse programs. I can give you an example. Daily medical service, daily vocational training, continuous professional counseling for rape victims, and manufacture and supply of artificial limbs for those victims who need them, and the community-based educational system, these programs for children, and peace education, and even micro-loan activities to former child soldiers who, you know, try to make a living for the rest of his life, and so on. All these things are, you know, are our achievements as well as innovation.
Great. Now, one of the main challenges the court is grappling with nowadays is its deteriorating relationship with the African Union in recent years. 34 individuals indicted by the court are African.
Yes.
32.
You are right.
Are African, and many African countries therefore are complaining about double standards and the court's alleged singling out of the subcontinent in its case selection. Mm-hmm. Do you think that's a fair criticism?
Not at all. You see, well, in response, at the outset, I really wish to emphasize that the ICC came into being by and large thanks to initiatives, wisdom, tenacity, and passion shown by African people, for which ICC is enormously grateful. At the moment, almost one-fourth of the ICC staff members are African, including the ICC prosecutor, Madame Bensouda, and the president of the Assembly of State Parties. African criticism about the ICC, which you raised in the form of question, is, in my view, either grossly unfounded or very unfair and misleading. I'll tell you why. Out of nine situations, it is true that all the country situations the ICC is dealing with are from Africa. Nine situations. Out of those nine, five African countries in trouble referred their own armed conflict to the ICC. Five African countries came all the way to The Hague. And they said, Mr. ICC, we had a terrible armed conflict domestically. We don't know how to handle them. So Mr. ICC, please come forward and help us. That's how we reached out. And in two other situations, it is the UN Security Council who made such a referral to us, Libya and Sudan. Again, two more African countries. And then in the case of the Côte d'Ivoire, actually it wasn't a state party, but the government people of Côte d'Ivoire came all the way to The Hague and publicly declared the acceptance of the ICC jurisdiction. That's why we were involved. Only in the case of Kenya, the ICC prosecutor, by his own initiatives, started the investigation. When he made that decision, he needed judicial approval, which he got, and then he went out with 100 blessing of the international community. I don't have to bother to mention names like Kofi Annan or Desmond Tutu or Nelson Mandela or these respectful leaders. Furthermore, the several social science surveys were taken internally in Kenya. The results shows that 98% of Kenyan people were strongly in support of the ICC prosecutor's initiative. That's how we started this the investigations at that crucial moment, the end of 2007 and the early part of 2008. So actually, we did not never deliberately chose only Africans. We never singled out Africans alone. And furthermore, the ICC prosecution has been conducting what we call a preliminary examinations in many parts of the world outside Africa, ranging from Colombia, Honduras, Afghanistan, Georgia, now Ukraine, and all these countries. You see, here in this context, it is my view, it is really heartbreaking to think of the suffering and plight of millions of victims in Africa. And the ICC should do something about this. you must understand this victim perspectives. I hope that the relationship between the ICC and the African Union in general should improve in the future, and that the ICC can soon have hopefully a small presence in the African Union premise, if not, then in Addis Ababa for mutually beneficial purposes.
Switching gears slightly, one often hears, especially at the UN, then that peace and justice are two sides of the same coin. But there may be some situations where we have trade-offs between the two. Mm-hmm. Dictators facing the threat of prosecutions or actual prosecutions have a strong incentive to cling to power, and ICC involvement can complicate or upset sensitive peace processes. Now, to what degree does, could, or should the prosecutor take into account these political factors in his case selection?
Well, this has to do with the peace versus justice argument, which has been debated for ages. So, but it may be very tempting to argue that it should be the responsibility of courts and tribunals not to upset the peace processes. And therefore, for example, not to issue any arrest warrants against the mass crime perpetrators due to their involvement in the peace process. Against this, however, it can be equally strongly argued that to have judges and prosecutors consider political factors, such as the interests of peace, would, in my view, inevitably introduce undesirable politicization into the legal process. Judges are judges. They are elected based on their ability to choose, interpret, and apply the law. They are not experts in peacemaking or politics. So you shouldn't expect them or want them to take such political decisions. In particular, the post-World War II tribunals have shown that justice is a fundamental building block of sustainable peace. So my catchphrase here is no sustainable peace without international criminal justice. Seems to me it is accepted now that peace and justice can and must go hand in hand. Personally, as a president of the ICC, it was a real challenge to keep the operation of this new international judiciary free from any political influence. I mean, judges are judges, so they are sitting in the cases every day, but as a representative public face of the institution and the representative of the institution, it is actually a challenge before me to keep this judicial institution free from political influence.
Great, thank you. Now I will ask the judge one or two more questions, and as those of you who have attended these events before know the routine, we will then turn over to the audience and give you an opportunity to engage with the judge. So please think of questions you would like to ask the judge. Judge, one of the challenges that has emerged recently for the court is the issue of witness protection.
Oh, yes.
And specifically in the Kenya context, the incidents of witness intimidation and the decision by a number of witnesses to pull out has derailed the prosecutor's case there and led her to drop the case against President Kenyatta. What can be done about this problem?
Well, before I make a direct answer to your question, initially, the relevant article of the Rome Statute about the witness protection was not very clear in terms of draftsmanship over who should be in charge of this. Should it be registry or should it be prosecution office? It was a very difficult internal issue that emerged at the initial stage. It took quite a while until my chamber, the appeals chamber, cleared the issue and in principle has given the responsibility to the registry. More fundamentally, however, it is a state responsibility to cooperate with the ICC on this particular matter. Therefore, political will of the ICC's state parties to ensure witness protection is essential. The cooperation of states with the ICC and the enforcement of its orders is another crucial aspect for the credibility and strength of the ICC. Since the ICC has no police force of its own, the ICC relies entirely on states to execute many judicial orders. ICC also requires their assistance in the provision of certain evidence to facilitate the appearance of witnesses, to identify and freeze assets of the suspects, and many other things. And here we know the prosecution witnesses who were residing inside Kenya were one by one very effectively intimidated, and in one case killed. We don't know who killed them, but so all of, in the end, all of this prosecution witnesses residing in the Kenya, you know, just gave up and all disappeared altogether. So from prosecutor's point of view, it is a very, very difficult. So that's why she threw the charge, some of the charges.
Great, thank you. Final question from me before I turn over to the audience on the issue of aggression. Mm-hmm. Now, the crime of aggression, even though included in the Rome Statute, wasn't defined at the time. In 2010, the Assembly of States Party managed to agree on a definition. The Rome Statute was amended, and the amendment may come into effect as early as 2017. So this will then allow the ICC to exercise its jurisdiction over the crime of aggression. Will we see the ICC prosecute heads of government for conducting a war of aggression?
Well, it is a little bit too premature to make any prediction on that respect. Because in order for the ICC to exercise its jurisdiction over aggression crime, as you correctly pointed out, it has to wait until 2017 plus some procedural requirements to be done. However, as a judicial body, I have one remark to make. As a judicial body, the ICC interacts and cooperates with the international and national political actors, such as the UN Security Council, regional organizations, and national governments. So we will probably, this will emerge more concretely in the near future as the 2017 approaches. At the review conference, ICC had for the first time in 2010 in Kampala, Uganda. Actually, it was remarkable that all the states, including non-state parties, for example, the United States, eventually were able to agree on the definition of the aggression crime and other procedural and other requirements. Of course, as you know, the definition was by and large based on the 1974 resolution of the UN. and Christian Venavesa, the president of the Assembly of States Parties at that moment, did much contribution to that happy results. But now when we have a close look at this consensus, there are still some more technical aspects to be improved or even redrafted. I don't know. We have to wait until 30 ratifications will.
We're at 23 or something. So we're fairly close. Yeah,
we are working very hard on that.
We will keep watching that space.
Yes.
Lots of opportunity for further controversy around the ICC. Mm-hmm. I will now open up the floor for questions from the audience. Who wants to be the first to ask a question?
I see the hand.
A person here on the aisle. Great, thank you.
I'm a junior fellow here. My name is Minal. My question is related to the United States. So the U.S. hasn't ratified the Rome Statute, and it's arguably the largest military presence in the world. How do you think that affects the long-term success of the ICC?
What is
Whether the fact that the United States hasn't ratified the Rome Statute as the biggest military power in the world affects the success of the ICC?
Yeah, as I impliedly indicated earlier, the United States was very hostile to the ICC. I just personally heard President Bush say, ICC is a kangaroo court because it doesn't even have any jury or something like this. However, when Obama administration came to power, US attitude toward the ICC has turned 180 degrees. So I can reveal to you comfortably at this moment that the United States has been quite quietly, but smoothly and carefully, closely cooperating with the ICC on the case-by-case basis. The ICC got a very crucial cooperation and assistance from the United States on certain occasions. And in my capacity, whenever I visited the United States, I managed to meet with US senators and members of the House and other influential people. In terms of the political reality in Washington, D.C., it is a matter of convincing two-thirds of the U.S. Senate for ratification. That means 68 senators out of 100. I have so far met maybe a dozen or so senators. Everyone I met shows their support and at least a sympathy toward for the ICC and its operation. But their reason, individual reason for support widely varies. One says, for example, out of his Christian belief, he supports ICC. Or some other says, his own humanitarian ground, he supports. Or you know, everybody has also, everybody has a different reason. But I see there is some positive you know, elements within the US Senate toward the ICC. Still, I'm not naive. It will take many years. Many years for the U.S. to ratify the Rome Statute, more than 10 years maybe. They have some technical reservation. For example, from their point of view, the ICC prosecutor seems to have been given quite strong power, effective power. What if this guy decided to abuse this power? This is quite serious consideration in the legal community, for example. They said, well, if it were within the United States, then there is here and there some you know, legitimate legal checking mechanisms available. On top of that, some media or some other pressure groups would apply the, you know, appropriate pressure. But at the ICC, what do you have as a checking mechanism? In response, I said, you see, the ICC prosecutor, when he tries to do something about investigation and prosecution, he has to get the judicial authorization from the pretrial chamber. That means his decision is subject to rather strict judicial scrutiny. I think that would be a good checking mechanism. So I hope that could sufficiently dispel this suspicion they have. So at the moment, we are getting along very well.
And if I may add, it's probably fair to say that some reevaluation of the ICC in Washington took already place before Obama became president. As you pointed out yourself, it was in 2005 that the Security Council, with US assent, referred the Darfur situation to the ICC. Who wants to be next? A gentleman here in the sixth row in the middle.
My name is Castella, a lawyer at the medical university. I totally agree with you, Mr. Song. The ICC has achieved much success, more than expected, and so innovation. And at the same time, I'd like to to reach for the victims to reach So I'd like to ask your estimation or observation about the success and effectiveness of reparation system in the ICC system.
Thank you for that question. You know, although the Rome Statute has all the detailed provisions, the a lot depends upon the initial leadership about how to shape this new baby, in what direction. I was the second president of the ICC, and one of my emphasis had to do with the victim protection. So I emphasized this victim trust fund for victims. The when the appeals chamber rendered the reparation order, it wasn't concrete enough or detailed enough. It simply showed the some sort of framework plus some sort of guiding principles for reparations, I mean compensation, rehabilitation, and restitution, and so on. So the appeals chamber sort of ordered the trust fund as an implementing agency for the reparation, judicial reparation orders, to come up with the concrete implementing or action plans for this. To do this, we just contacted as many victims as possible in various affected communities in DRC and Uganda and elsewhere. I also did it personally a number of occasions. When you visit an affected community, there is no men. Either tiny kids or widows, regardless of their ages, the young woman or old woman, only two groups of people in the village. And when I personally directly ask these the widows, mothers, what do you want? We have a legal mechanism under which we could, if we want, hand you certain damages in cash. We could do it. So would you like to take it? And some mothers in quite a few villages said, no, sir, no, thank you. You know, our living standard couldn't go further below than now. So we have been successfully, we have survived until now. So even if you would give us some cash, that wouldn't make much difference. Once we just spend them all for a week or two, then we will be again empty-handed. Nothing happens. So I said, then what do you want? And they said, you know, our children never seen a book, never had any toy. They don't even know the literal meaning of the word school. So I just tested this. I asked one small boy, do you know what school is? And his answer was, well, I don't know, but it sounds like a kind of axe my father used to use, something like this. So these ladies came back to me with their own proposal. We don't need any cash, so please come back with really necessary community-based educational programs for children. You know, we want our children to be well educated after peace came back to our village. I think I was very moved, and I think these ladies could say that because they are mothers, because they are mothers who are primarily interested in the well-being of their own tiny children. So we did some sort of contact, and so it's not the scientific survey, but this one. So the trust fund will come up with these certain programs, but the trust fund is short of money. And in March last year, when your prime minister attended the Nuclear Security Summit in The Hague, Prime Minister Abe quietly visited the court and just handed $500,000 to be accounted for the trust fund. You know, we need that kind of money for protection of the trust, the victims.
Great, thank you. Who next? Veselin.
Thank you, Veselin Popovsky, teaching law in Jindal Global Law School. Thank you, Judge, for your excellent insider's view of the tribunal. My question is with regard of Libya and the ICC. Although the Security Council Resolution 1970 gives a referral to prosecute a list of names, and some of those are in custody in Libya, Libya claims Article 17 exemption based on domestic jurisdiction prevalence. And the ICC also claims a Security Council referral as a mandate. So in such dilemma, what would the ICC do? Thank you.
What happened to the Libya situation judicially is that ICC chambers denied admissibility of al-Senussi case. That means al-Senussi can be tried domestically by the Libyan court. On the other hand, in the case of al-Islam Gaddafi, the ICC chamber admitted admissibility of that case. That means the Libyan government should surrender al-Islam Gaddafi to the ICC so that the ICC can try Mr. Gaddafi. But they refused so far. You see, as you may know, when ICC appointed a council, duty council, ex officio, to represent al-Islam Gaddafi before the ICC, this court appointed a lawyer, it's an Australian young lady, and her Arabic language interpreter and two others were sent to Libya to meet the al-Islam Gaddafi, because it's her client. You know, all the international conventions unanimously guarantee that the council is entitled to have an interview with their own client. So it's simply an exercise of international convention on the humanitarian ground. And as soon as these four ICC staff members arrived, and the Libyan authorities just arrest them and put them in jail. That gave me a totally sleepless 26 days for negotiation with the Libyan authorities. And my problem was, now I can reveal this. Immediately, I managed to contact the president of Libya, and he and I were on the phone for 2.5 hours One of my secretaries was Moroccan. She was standing in between and right next to me and just to be an interpreter. So 2.5 hours, Libyan president and I just exchanged views. And he said, the president said, "President Song, don't worry. They will all be released within the next 72 hours. Don't worry about that." What I found out is that subsequently is that there are so many Indians and no chief. We don't know, and even they themselves don't know who has a decision-making authority. The president is just nobody. He was a president, but he has no power. And there's the Gaddafi is not detained by the central authority in Tripoli. He is still detained by the Zintani, local Zintani militia command. And then this local militia maintains that, well, the Libyan revolution would not be successful without 300 lives sacrificed from Zintan. I mean, sacrifice of 300 Zintani young men. So we need some compensation. So unless and until the central government, for example, would actually give us $500 million, we would never even dream of surrendering al-Islam Gaddafi to Tripoli, not to mention to the Hague. That's the situation. They internally, within the government, they don't know what to do. And we don't know, and they themselves don't know who has the decision-making authority. This is a situation. Legally, it's clear. I mean, in the case of Gaddafi, his case is admissible to the ICC. In the case of al-Sinusi, his case is not admissible to the ICC. You see, the difference is, Libya has a death penalty. If they continue to try al-Islam domestically, then he might be hanged. If, on the other hand, he would be sent to The Hague, Rome statute doesn't recognize a death penalty. So it's a huge difference.
We have time for one last question. If the question is brief, please, here.
Thank you very much for coming tonight. I have a very hypothetical question. It's set in the near future, perhaps. In our societies that are currently becoming more reliant on technology, we've had reports of restricted cyber espionage, etc. And obviously, right now, I believe you deal mainly with cases of physical aggression in states. Let's say in the future, one state declares cyber warfare against another, and there's no physical warfare, but this cyber warfare starts affecting citizens in the long term. Do you think that the ICC could possibly handle such cases in the future? I mean, are there any vague ideas within the ICC about what to do in future societies, future scenarios?
I think it's a very creative question. You see, the more generally, ICC has subject matter jurisdiction only over four distinct crimes, because we believe those four crimes are the most serious threat to the world peace and security. Now, but when we had a review conference in 5 years ago, many states parties attended with a proposal of adding some more crimes to the ICC jurisdiction. For example, terrorism, use of nuclear weapons, or even drug trafficking, and things like this. But none of these proposals was accepted. and even if it was accepted, then it's a matter of amending the basic treaty statute. Then in order for this amendment to be effective, you know how difficult procedurally? You have to get two-thirds approval to pass this amendment. And in order for this amendment to be effective, you have to have 7/8 ratifications. So virtually it is impossible. Therefore, then can we achieve the pretty much a similar result through interpretation? So for example, within the definition of war crime, can we add cyber war crime, as you pointed out, through interpretation? Well, that may be it's one assignment to be done by the lawyers, ICC lawyers. But I have to give another example. Under the Rome Statute, the trial in absentia is strictly prohibited. But on the other hand, the sitting president of Kenya, Uhuru Kenyatta, appeared before the proceeding, and he actually requested that you may go on to trial about me, but I want to stay in Nairobi, and why don't you conduct a trial, through all the electronic means. So then it's a question of interpretation. At the moment, under the statute, presence requirement always means physical presence. Now, can you, through interpretation, can you say this presence requirement could be electronic or virtual? It's again up to we need lawyers' ingenuity about interpretation.
Well, thank you so much. Unfortunately, we've come to the end of this event. As frequent visitors here know, we usually offer drinks and a little bite in the back, but tonight we unfortunately can't because the judge has a commitment right after this event, which means we unfortunately have to escort him rapidly out of this room. So I beg for your forgiveness if we will not allow you to accost him with any further questions you may have. So all that's left for me to say is to thank you, Judge, for being both inspirational and insightful, and for thanking the audience for being so engaging. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
It was a great pleasure.